All right, hope you've enjoyed the meal so far, and now I'd like to introduce our guest speaker. It's my privilege and honor. The political career of Herman Van Rompuy spans over more than 30 years. He's held many different political posts of high rank in Belgium, including being a member of the Belgian Senate, Deputy Prime Minister, Minister for the Budget, Member of the Chamber of Representatives, Minister of State, the President of the Belgian Chamber of Representatives, and most recently, Prime Minister of Belgium since December 30th, 2008. Additionally, he holds a doctorate in economics, and since 1982 has also been a professor at the Vlaams Economische Hogeschool in Brussels. I also understand that you are an accomplished poet in your own right. He has a particular passion for the haiku genre. I don't know if he'll speak much about that tonight, but he's at least agreed to speak to us tonight a bit about the impact of the recent elections and, of course, the economy and the measures that Belgium is thinking about with regard to companies and employees. Mr. Prime Minister, given your years of policy experience and your economist training, we really look forward to your remarks, and just like to say that AmCham Belgium, as always, is ready and willing to engage in any constructive dialogue that you would find helpful to advance the Belgian economy and to improve the country. So I'd also like to thank you once again so much on behalf of the entire membership and on behalf of AmCham Belgium for taking time out of what must just be an insanely busy schedule given the recent elections and the upcoming presidency of Belgium in the EU to take time to be with us here this evening. We really appreciate it. So without any further ado, please join me in welcoming Prime Minister Van Rompuy.
Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen, I confess I hesitated a lot before accepting to make a speech here this evening, because I saw the invitation, Le Méridien Hotel. Well, the end of last year, the last meeting to convince me at last to become Prime Minister was in this hotel. Place for me. Ladies and gentlemen, it is an honor and a pleasure to me for me to address this distinguished audience of the executives at the annual dinner of the AmCham, the American Chamber of Commerce in our country in Belgium. Allow me to start with a brief reference to the more than a century-old relationship between our two peoples. We may not forget indeed that thousands of Belgians emigrated to the United States on the American Immigration Wall of Honor on New York's Ellis Island. We can see the names of 63,000 Belgians who entered the United States between 1892 and 1954, mostly for economic reasons. We have our own diaspora in the United States. Today I am proud to remind this fact at the occasion of my presence here at your chamber and celebrate the vitality of our economic and political bonds. On a personal note, I'm glad to stand here before you exactly 30 years after writing the speech of my predecessor, former Prime Minister Leo Tindemans. I was his advisor, and his son is here this evening. So 30 years later, I am my own man at last. Let me emphasize how much Belgium values the continued presence of the American business community. Big American companies have long established branches in Belgium. These branches allow Belgium to claim the title of the corporate headquarters of Europe. The The United States is the biggest foreign direct investor in Belgium, as you mentioned. Recent investments are exemplary of the new economy and include software companies such as Google and service providers ranging from Starbucks to boutique law firms. It is fair to say that the American business community is contributing substantially to Belgium's welfare by creating value added through employment, innovative R&D, and new business concepts. The past 61 years, AmCham has played a unique role as go-between for the federal government and the American business society. We are here today to celebrate that long-standing partnership. I think it is important we listen to your comments on the business climate in Belgium and what could be done to improve it. The current economic hardship makes this even more important. In this short introduction, I would like to share my views on recent policy measures that will help us fighting the crisis. In spite of what is sometimes being said, important measures have been taken the last 18 months by the federal government especially to address the needs of companies and their employees. The social partners playing an important role in our country took their responsibility in times of crisis. That wasn't the case in the 80s and in the 90s, even not in the 70s. They concluded a biannual social agreement in which they agreed that the average wage mass per employee would not rise in real terms. Admittedly, the federal government helped out by reducing the taxes on labor with some kind of general wage subsidy. Later on, social partners were unable this time to agree upon measures introducing a form of temporary unemployment for white-collar workers. The government took its responsibility and adopted an alternative measure with the same objective. In all these issues, the federal government was approached as some kind of lender of last resort. Remember your economic textbooks long ago. Following the problems of major financial institutions, it is a role we were already used to, and we were able to find an answer to all these concerns. Apart from the merits of the decisions in itself, the danger of social unrest, as for instance in France, has been thwarted. Especially in times of crisis, social peace is invaluable. Let me now elaborate on the key measures we have taken to meet the needs of companies and employees in times of crisis. These specific measures come on top of a set of automatic stabilizers, which are much more important in Europe, certainly in Belgium, than in the United States. Indeed, in this year's budget, we will not compensate for the loss in tax revenue and the sharp increase in social expenditures, a result of our well-established social welfare system. Some international observers sometimes criticize the lack of an ambitious European recovery plan and refer to the 800 billion stimulus plan of President Obama. They forget that in Europe, a lot of stimulus comes automatically given our more generous welfare systems. That being said, the high public deficit justifies a careful approach from the Belgian authorities. The public deficit will deteriorate with 5.8% of GDP between 2007 and 2010. This is in line with the deterioration in the Eurozone, but well below the deterioration of the deficit to 11.4% in the United States. As a consequence, in Belgium, debt will rise with 90% of GDP, while it will rise with 34% percentage point in the United States. Nonetheless, the reduction of the structural deficit of above 4 or 5% of GDP is one of the highest priorities for Belgium in the coming years. The Belgian Recovery Plan, in essence, adds to these automatic stabilizers in three ways. First, by giving oxygen to companies.